All right. Welcome back, everybody. Sports Chat.
503.
Okay, man. We are here. We got the shirts on. We're Team Sports Chat today. We're ready to roll on this bad boy.
Yeah.
All right, everybody. Happy holidays to everybody out there. For the first time, thanks a lot. If you've been here for a while, appreciate the help and all that stuff. This week, we got a plenty of stuff. We're just past Christmas, so we got a little bit of NBA. We got some the year in review we'll talk about, the updates with the Duckies and the, anything else with the NCAA tournament and all that or whatever. That's on the way. And then NFL. And we got our top 10 rules. The top 10 this week is our top 10 rules for Christmas shopping now that we're done with that whole deal.
Yeah, man.
Okay, first of all, let's do a little update on the Ducks. Let's do anything. You got anything on the update there?
No, I don't know. The Ducks, what's his name? The Movember guy is going to be out.
Yeah, lineman.
Ineligible.
Yeah, Nick Cody's done.
Yeah.
I mean, we talked so much about it the last time. I don't think we have too much more to talk about. It's pretty quiet on the home front.
Yeah, there hasn't been, well, obviously with Chip Kelly, you know, there hasn't been a lot about him in the news. I'm still excited. I guess the one thing that we didn't talk about was, and we can get into this in a little bit, is about Johnny Manziel getting the Heisman over Klein. But cause it would have been sweet to play the Heisman Trophy winner in the Fiesta Bowl. But
and the last time we went down there with Newton.
Yeah, exactly. And so, yeah, but other than that, you know, it's basically game on. We've got my man Nobi going down.
I'm excited. I got the tickets. Yeah, I would show them to you here, but they're upstairs. I've totally spaced on trying to get them. But, got the tickets. We're excited. We're leaving here pretty soon. The team's already down there. They already got the conference press conference. I already heard Kelly's press conference today is pretty sweet.
Nice.
The biggest big news, obviously, is people just continually to talk about, is Kelly leaving? Is this the last game? Is it worried about recruits? Are people worried about it?
Yeah.
The sanctions, we can talk about that little deal a little bit that we possibly now we're looking at, you know, we thought maybe we were going to get a slap on the wrist. Possibly now we're going to get more than that. It could be a bowl ban. Could be a restriction of
scholarships,
whatever the deal is. Yeah. So, you know, those are kind of things we've talked about before. I have a sinking suspicion Kelly stays.
Yeah, me too.
I feel like he had his opportunity last year. He didn't take it.
No.
Boom.
Yeah.
I think he stays. It could just be the homer in me. I'm hoping that he stays. I wrote the guy in as the governor. I didn't like either the candidates, Republican or Democrat. I wrote the guy in, Chip Kelly. He's done nothing to do with win, but all in the games that he hasn't, sometimes that blame could be laid on him. So it's not like the guy's the ultimate savior of types, you know?
Yeah.
The other thing about the sanctions, I think, is interesting. I've said it numerous times. I don't think they're going to be as severe as SC or as Ohio State because the players weren't getting paid.
Yeah.
The biggest thing here is that you're paying a scout. Now, are you paying a scout and did the player get the money? No.
Right.
So you're paying a scout. So basically the way that they say it is that you have an extra coach on your roster. You're because you're paying him. Meaning he's an assistant in some way, shape, or
employee,
form.
Employee. Somehow,
and then if he's a coach, he can't do what he's doing with the scouting service. So the biggest deal with me is that they ran it through the compliance department, and the compliance department at Oregon said yes. So are you busting the football team, the football coach, or the compliance department if you're the NCAA?
Right.
Personally, if I'm the NCAA and I say, okay, the compliance department, the team that works for me, they're the ones who okayed it.
They're the ones
who need to be punished here.
Exactly.
I don't necessarily see that's going to happen. I think that they're going to take a high-profile team and a high-profile case and maybe make some sort of a statement on it.
Yeah.
Because I think they're complete idiots for the most part. The NCAA has screwed everything up.
Yeah.
I mean, I just think it's I just don't understand. Find the school money. Do what you're going to do. I don't understand why Penn State couldn't go to a bowl game. I don't understand why SC couldn't go to a bowl game, those couple years. And I don't understand why Ohio State can't go to a bowl game. They're undefeated.
Yeah.
And those kids got some goddamn free tattoos. Who the hell gives a shit?
Yeah.
I mean, when you're talking about, you know, Cam Newton and the dad says, yes, I was asking $200,000 for 1 year for my kid. And they're like, nope, nothing to see here. No, he was awesome for us.
Yeah.
And, Terrell Pryor.
Goddamn
free
him.
Tattoo.
Yeah.
That makes no sense to me.
Yeah.
And I think that the same thing could happen with Oregon, where if you get a suspension or we're talking about a limited scholarship or any of those kind of things, I think it's going to play right into the favor of all these other teams and let them be able to do what they're going to do, which is going to suck for Oregon because, you know, just like SC can come back, they're goddamn the Trojans.
Yeah.
But Oregon is on a run right now that if you clip them off right now, it might take a little while for Oregon to rebuild itself.
So which is the biggest penalty in terms of Oregon? Would it be Reduction of scholarships or bowl ban, yeah.
Probably bowl ban.
That's what I was thinking, too.
Yeah, we got to have the bowl, man. Yeah. We're going to be in a bowl right now. The way the team's rolling, even if you lose Kelly, you're still going to be in a bowl.
Yeah.
You know, you got to have that bowl. You got to have those boosters going to those bowl games. You got to have that money coming into the conference. You got to have everything rolling on that level.
Yeah.
And I really think the biggest thing when we look at these sanctions is, you know, you could probably get away with it with some scholarship reductions, but the scholarship reductions hurts your depth. If your depth isn't that good, it's going to show up at some point. You're going to lose games. Then you're going to be in a lesser bowl.
Yeah.
So it's like, does SC really care about being in the Sun Bowl right now? No. Maybe they would like to have a bowl ban this year because their bowl option is kind of shitty in their minds.
Mm-hmm.
Even though there's a lot of teams would love that bowl.
Oh, sure,
you know? So it's just one of those deals where I think that the bowl ban would be harder to swallow for Duck fans, but the restrictions on the scholarship might be actually harder on the football team.
Yeah.
So, depending on who you're trying to punish there. I would love for them to just say, Phil, cut us a check.
Yeah, and yeah, that's a good point because, I mean, and another thing that the
and
way...
25 grand, I'm sorry to go back to the second.
Yeah, yeah.
But the Willie Lyles thing is 25 grand.
Yeah.
There are schools that pay 200 grand for recruiting.
Yeah.
We're talking 25 grand.
Yeah. Nobody's getting rich off that. And from what I understand is Oregon had set up some penalties for itself. In response to this, that it then went to the NCAA with.
They both agreed on the crime that was committed, or the penalty.
Yeah.
Was not that they agreed on.
Yeah.
They didn't agree on how they'd be penalized, but they all agreed on the infraction.
Yeah, because I guess what typically happens is the school can say, okay, we'll do this, this, and this to penalize ourselves.
Right, because it's all run by...
Yeah, I mean, is that okay with you? And then, as in this case, the NCAA comes back and says,
no,
your penalties are not strict enough. We're going to have a committee hearing and dictate what the more appropriate penalties will be.
So
I'd like
I don't know
to
if
see,
Kelly stays through that or not.
Yeah, because that's a great point, because that would be a big catalyst in, because if you're not going to bowl games, I mean,
that's
he's
tough.
Basically playing for
that's
now.
That's tough.
Yeah, but...
basically it there, I mean...
Yeah, I think we'll be okay, though. Yeah. I don't think they'll... One question I have, though, is where does the PAC12 stand in all this? Does the
I don't think they can do a damn thing.
Yeah, because I would think, you know, with the amount of money that Oregon is bringing into the conference by...
And SC was for
a
couple years.
You would think that the PAC12 would be backing Oregon, but I don't know, maybe that's just not how
work. The head of the NCAA was the university president of Washington. The other one who's a head, top dog in the NCAA, was the head of Oregon State at one point.
So there is
some serious influence in the PAC-12, and the influence PAC-12 are from the two biggest rivals of Oregon.
Exactly.
So, I don't know. It feels like there's a witch hunt kind of thing, and it feels like that from Ohio State. I felt like they were after Ohio State, and I felt like they were after SC, and I feel like they were after... You know, Auburn but nobody's after Bama.
Yeah.
Nobody's after Florida now. Yeah. And I hear about these infractions they have of like in the 40 infractions a year.
Yeah.
In recruiting.
Yeah.
So where's all the news on that? And I'm not trying to be on that level, but I'm just trying to say that we got a one deal for 25 grand that we had. And this is, you're dealing with a young coach. He put it through the compliance department. The compliance department signed off on it. It was a university check. It's not like it's some random booster
who's some
influencing
back alley
they're not
cash
in
a brown paper bag deal.
The guy from Miami, that Melvin Shapiro or whatever, they was the guy who was giving guys checks and everything. I mean, that was a booster giving money to players. Yeah. We're talking about the university paying a scout.
Yeah, for his opinion on potential recruits.
Yeah, and really, it really came down to the fact that he was the guy who helped bring guys up and out to Oregon on the recruiting trips. The handwritten letter that Kelly wrote to the guy is all about, hey, thanks for bringing these guys up there, up here. And then hopefully we can get Lake up here as well. And this was Dante Williams and Lake Seastrunk and all these guys coming from Texas the year right after LaMichael came.
Mm.
So, you know, you're just talking about, hey, this happens all over the country. It's happened forever. You get a team from Oregon. How much influence do they have over kids from Texas?
Yeah.
Okay, how many real opportunities can you have where people on the ground that actually can influence kids and actually help them choose, quote unquote, the best position for them?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, you go to a position like this. The kid said, "Hey, let's go here. Let's go to Oregon." The kid doesn't want to go to Oregon. Look at Seastrunk. Now he's going to Baylor. Seastrunk thinks he's going to be the Heisman Trophy winner next year.
He had a great game this last game. Was it the bowl game or was it the last game of the year?
Yeah. I don't know. So I think it's going to be a deal that you're going to see some news, and then NCAA wants that.
Yeah.
And I don't think it's going to be that good for Oregon. I am going to soak this up like it's the last one, though, because I don't know if we're going to be in the bowl, if they come down with the sanction, they say bowl ban next year. You never know.
Yeah,
you never know. And so I'm going to be, I'm going to be soaking this thing up like it is fool's gold.
Yeah.
Basketball team, real quick, on the Duckies is doing pretty well. Yeah. They've got a couple losses there. I went and saw the Nebraska game, and Nebraska had a kid who was 6'11", 320 pounds.
Holy shit.
Biggest basketball player I've ever seen. White guy.
Big country.
Dude, we're talking huge country.
Okay, this the dude, whole country.
Dude, this dude is the biggest guy I've ever seen.
Really?
I'm not kidding you. 6'11", okay? It's true 6'11", tallest guy on the floor.
Yeah.
320 pounds.
Wow, man. Okay? That's like a lineman, dude.
Oh, dude, but 6'11".
Yeah, no shit. Yeah, even bigger.
I mean, unreal. Guy had about two or three wide open layups,
yeah.
Nothing. So his game wasn't tight. And Oregon blew him open. But Oregon looks good. The kid from Iran looks good. Kazemi, I think is how they pronounce it. But Arsalan is what I'm calling him. And then the freshman looked real good. The point guard, Artis, looks good. And then Damian Dotson, the shooting guard, looks good.
Yeah.
So I think the Ducks can make a little run here. The Pac-12 looks somewhat light, except for Arizona looks good.
Yeah, Arizona's so, like three or four in the country.
Yeah, if Oregon could sneak out a couple victories in the Pac-12, we might be able to make some noise.
Now, how was the atmosphere at the game?
It was good, but it's during the break, you know, so the kids aren't there. I mean, it's pretty light.
So let's talk about the Pac-12 a little bit. Yep. Arizona wins bowl game.
Yeah,
impressive. And that was a pretty wild one.
Yeah, it was. I was digging it, man. I was excited to see him pull it
UCLA
out.
Plays tonight, and Beavs are next. And other than that, do we have a loss?
Washington lost to Boise State. They should have won the game, man. It. Minute 15 left, Boise State kicks the field goal for the win.
And then I think they open the season next year against Boise State.
Oh, good.
Yeah.
They're going to be good next year, man. I'm telling you, Washington... Yeah. And Sarkisian up there. They got a program.
If they can figure it out, I think they'll be okay.
Yeah, I agree, man.
Okay, let's do NFL here.
Yeah, let me yell one time quick about the Beavs. So the Beavs decided to go start with Vaz.
Oh, that's right.
Instead of Mannion. What do you think of that?
Yeah, I think it's six doesn't happen the other.
Yeah.
I think the key thing with Mannion is that the guy is a mannequin.
Yeah.
The guy has no moves.
Yeah.
And you know Texas is going to bring it.
Yeah.
Texas is faster than Oregon State.
Yeah.
They're probably stronger. Texas has the best recruiting class every year.
Yeah, they do.
They got to have some athletes down there.
Yeah.
Okay, so you know they're going to bring it, especially off the edge.
Yeah.
So Oregon State's got to have somebody who can get out of the pocket a little bit.
Yeah.
Vaz, I think, is okay. I think he puts the ball on the money. I think he puts it a little bit softer than Mannion does. Mannion kind of cannons the ball a little bit.
Yeah.
But Mannion just, the guy can't get out of his own way.
Yeah.
The guy, he's like Roethlisberger sometimes. He can't get out of the pocket.
Yeah.
And he doesn't have the moves like Roethlisberger to extend the play.
I think Oregon State has a good shot. I think their defense.
I think so too.
Throw the ball with Wheaton and
I'm starting to think. I agree. But I'm starting to think that Texas has a better opportunity to win than I was 2 weeks ago.
Yeah, but wouldn't that be nice to see OSU come out?
It would be great. I think Oregon State can do it, and it would be great to see them win in Texas. I think that'd be awesome.
Yeah.
Yeah. Especially when you have, you know, Quiz as one of the better players on that Atlanta Falcons team from Texas, his brother as well. But you have other kids. You get start getting some kids from Texas into OSU.
Yeah.
Look what happens, man.
Yep.
Let's do NFL.
Yes.
Okay, NFL, Steelers are done.
Yeah.
That was pathetic. 2 weeks in a row where Roethlisberger throws the interception in overtime that sets up the field goal that we lose the game you shouldn't lose.
Yeah, isn't that frustrating?
You have to win the games to go to the playoffs, and you lose them both.
Yeah.
You're going in the last week of the season, you're already done. You lose to the goddamn Bengals. Oh, my God.
Yeah.
And, Lord. I mean, you can't run the ball. You cannot goddamn run the ball in Pittsburgh?
Yeah.
How can Pittsburgh have such a shitty offensive line?
Since when does that happen? Yeah.
Jesus Christ. And then they get the kid from Stanford, and he's hurt this year, DeCastro, and he was just getting his ass blown off the ball by the freaking Bengals.
Yeah.
The Bengals looked like the goddamn 85 Bears.
Yeah, they did, man. Yeah, they did.
Batch wins the game against Baltimore. And you think, here we go.
Yeah, thank God.
Finally.
Yeah.
The season is going to resurrect itself. Finally. Oh, no. Roethlisberger comes back the next week. You should have started Batch. You lose to the goddamn Chargers at home. The Chargers came into Pittsburgh and blew them out. Blew them out. Okay, never mind. We'll be fine. Let's do the next one. No. Cowboys. No.
Yeah, Bengals.
Yep. Oh! So anyway, so great. So then the other stuff that's happening is who the hell thought that the goddamn Seahawks, the Colts, and the goddamn Redskins were all going to be teams you wouldn't want to see in the playoffs.
I know. It's crazy. And you know, another team right now that I wouldn't want to face if I was...
The Colts are better than the Steelers.
Yeah, isn't that nuts? Luck in his first year, man.
What the hell happened?
Yeah, it's unbelievable. And
so are the Bengals.
And the Seahawks go undefeated at home, blow out San Francisco.
An asterisk. They should have lost that Monday night.
Yeah, that's true.
But you're right. They go undefeated at home. They have a great team.
Yeah, they do, man. And
stud defenses, great running game, quarterback that doesn't make mistakes.
Yeah, Lynch and Wilson back there.
And a good running or a good return game with the Washington. Washington.
Yeah, that's right.
Money. Yeah. He set Hester's record. He broke Hester's
record. Oh, did he?
Yes.
Oh, damn, man.
No, he's legit.
Nice.
Yeah. Not on the punt. I think on the kickoff or something. Anyway, he's money.
Yeah. And the other team that I think is going to end up making the playoffs that I wouldn't want to face because they're really peaking right now, too, is Minnesota. Adrian Peterson is unstoppable right now in the backfield. Yeah. He has a chance against, I think it's New England, or no, Green Bay, to set the single-season rushing record.
I don't think he's going
to
do it.
Yeah, he got 210 earlier in the year against Green Bay, but I don't think
it's going to happen.
Yeah, I don't think it's going to happen.
I don't think it's going to happen. But Jerry Rice's record did break, and I saw that one.
Yeah, was that Calvin Johnson?
Yeah.
Yeah.
That guy is a beast. Yeah. They say that when he comes off the bus, he looks like an offensive lineman.
Really?
Well, I mean, not as a fat ass, but like
he's
the size and so, I mean, he looks like a Javon Curse type.
Damn, man.
Yeah.
Damn.
So you can throw the ball to him over the middle like a tight end. You can throw the ball to him deep. Jerry Rice's passes were legitimate wide receiver outs.
Yeah.
Calvin Johnson is a little bit of a hybrid, it seems like.
Yeah, it's almost like a...
Terrell Owens type.
Yeah, almost kind of like a you've got a mismatch with a tight end on a DB out there.
Yes, it's unfair.
Yeah.
And then the other thing I think is interesting about the NFL is you have a team like the Giants, just like the Steelers, who can't get out of their own goddamn way.
Yeah.
They got hammered. I mean hammered by Atlanta.
Yeah.
Blown out. Like, the college version would be a 56-0 kind of a game.
Yeah.
They had nothing. And that was a team that halfway through the season you think, maybe they can make a run. Maybe they can do something about it.
Yeah.
No.
Yeah.
So now you're looking at goddamn RG3 with the Redskins. Okay. They're better than the Giants.
Yeah.
Who would have thought of that? Okay.
Unbelievable.
And then Pittsburgh is done. The Bengals are better than them.
Yeah.
The Niners are now hobbling their way into the playoffs and just got hammered. I mean, hammered.
Yeah.
Hammered by Seattle up there.
Yeah, and they just got done beating the Patriots, didn't they?
Oh, yeah. They went from beating the Patriots to getting blown in Seattle. That happens sometimes, but Seattle looks absolutely legit. When they can go in and play a team like, the Falcons and play it. Like, they played against the Niners.
Oh, yeah.
I wouldn't want to be the Falcons.
Yeah, no shit. The last thing I want to say is I never thought Peyton Manning and the Broncos would be doing this well. They have, I think...
Phenomenal.
Yeah, I think this is, like, his... I heard a stat, like, his seventh or his ninth season with 12 or more wins as a team. Dude, Peyton Manning.
And he's on a real team. Like, this team could be better than some of the teams that you played on in Indianapolis.
Yeah.
Great defense.
Yeah, defense.
Super good rush ends.
Yeah.
Okay. And a good running game.
Yeah.
So you're talking about three things that really Indianapolis never really had.
Exactly.
You had Edgerrin James.
Yeah. For a bit.
But you didn't have the best Edgerrin.
No.
You had him at the decline of his career.
Right.
But you're talking about Peyton Manning is on a team where he doesn't have to carry the ship now.
Yeah.
So now the players are goddamn open as.
Yeah.
I mean, and that Stokely.
Yeah.
He keeps hitting that Stokely over the middle. Nobody can guard that guy.
Yeah, no doubt, man. I like him. You know, they're tough. I wouldn't want to see him in the playoffs.
Yeah. I was surprised with Denver. I'm surprised with Indy. And I'm surprised with Washington. I didn't see that coming. So that's what happens there. Okay, let's go NBA real quick.
Yeah.
Okay, NBA is firing off. The Lakers look like they're kind of right of the ship. They got back to 500. Nash is back. They're still slow. They're still going to get beat by Memphis.
and Oklahoma City.
Oklahoma City, and, the
Clippers.
And then the Clippers, yeah.
The Clippers are raw, and they don't even have they still got guys on the bench who haven't played yet.
Yeah, they still got waiting on Chauncey to come back.
Yeah, and Grant Hill.
That's right, yeah, yeah.
I mean, so you're talking about a team right now where Jamal Crawford could be your best player.
Yeah.
Okay? Griffin doesn't even have to be the workhorse that he is or can be.
Yeah.
He can just fly around and get open boards. He's like, him and that DeAndre Jordan, all they do is just grab open boards.
Yeah, grab open
and
boards.
And stuff them right back in the hole.
Exactly.
Oh, my God, it's fun to watch.
Yeah, and it's a great setup down there with Chris Paul, too, because he's a facilitator. He can do all that.
And he can get 20 and 10 a night.
Yeah, if everything falls off the ship, Chris Paul can be.
Because they're over 100 points.
Yeah.
Other thing I like about the NBA is you get the Christmas day, you're done. Now Christmas, it's now the season you can start focusing on.
Yeah.
You get that first couple of months, and I'm watching, you know, Memphis, and I'm watching these other teams I think are really good. Yeah. But now's the time where you're going to see who's going to get their legs underneath them a little bit. Yep. Start to separate these things out a little bit.
Yeah. Yeah, and Avery Johnson gone.
Gets fired. That's pretty weak. I mean, you get into the new building, you're the new thing. Why throw?
Yeah, I don't know.
PJ Carlissimo is gonna be the coach. Come on now.
Yeah, you know that's not gonna last. No. And you got because you've lost a couple times to the Knicks now, and you're trying to make the Knicks your big rival team because now technically you're both. Calling
it's not happening,
yourself
especially
from
with
New
the
York.
Knicks being as good as they are this year.
Yeah, come I on, know, man. Kidd and Chandler and wait for Stoudemire to come back.
Oh, dude.
So, yeah.
Yeah, they look raw. But Felton got injured. He's out for like a month.
Oh, is that right?
Yeah, dislocated his finger or broke his finger or something. I don't know, some sort of thing. He's been having a nice year.
Yeah, I'm surprised.
Anything else with the NBA? NBA is pretty exciting.
Yeah, it's going good so far this year.
LeBron.
Yeah, LeBron's doing nice. Durant, Kobe's leading the NBA in scoring again.
Kobe's absolutely raw.
Yeah, you've got the Blazers are doing pretty good. They beat Sacramento last night. They've got Batum's looking good, real good. Lillard had the game-winning shot a couple nights ago.
Lillard looks raw. I mean, I'm talking with a friend. I was gonna go to the game the other night, and at the end of the day, said no, I'm gonna go with the family, check out some Christmas lights. Awesome. But the point, yeah, exactly. Made that fatherly move. Do I go Blazer game or family? All right.
Yeah,
I've seen the
season.
Kings. But I'll tell you what, Lillard does look raw, and he looks so smooth. I'm a big believer that Chris Paul is best point guard in the league. I think most people would agree with that. I think the second best point guard is Drew Holiday.
I love
Drew Holiday. Being a Sixer fan, I think I'm biased there. But I think Lillard reminds me a lot of Drew Holiday. He also reminds me a lot of Derrick Rose. He's got this real intensity that he can put the ball on the floor and get past you and get to the lane.
Mm-hmm.
But he has that step back, silky ass jumper that he is right on the money with.
Yeah.
So, the point guard in Portland has not had that jumper ever.
Yeah.
Damon Stoudemire is basically the only point guard, if you classify Danny Ainge for that year or two with point guard. But we've only had one point guard that could actually step back and hit the jumper.
Yeah.
Terry Porter couldn't do it. None of those, I mean, those guys are all spot-up shooters.
Right, exactly.
All of them.
Yep.
That adds such a huge dynamic. When you look at Russell Westbrook,
mm-hmm.
the thing that separates him from Derrick Rose is that pull-up jumper.
Yeah.
You know, Derrick Rose doesn't have that pull-up jumper consistently like
Westbrook
does.
Yeah, I agree with
that, man. So, you're looking at Westbrook, you're looking at Rose, you're looking at Drew Holiday, you're looking at the next generation of point guards
mm-hmm.
that are out there. Lillard's in that mix.
Yeah, I agree, man.
Yep.
He's doing really well.
And that might keep Aldridge.
Yeah,
see,
that's a good point.
And then you start to have, you keep Batum,
yep.
you get a little bit of finesse team. It's not going to blow anybody away physically. But you get that team that can score some buckets. They can all shoot the ball.
Yeah.
You need to shoot the ball. I would love to see him bring in a really nice, effective veteran two guard.
Yeah.
Put Matthews on the bench and bring in a nice two guard.
Yeah, me too.
I mean, obviously everybody wants a Joe Johnson type.
Yeah.
But that's the kind of guy I'd like to see.
Yeah.
I mean, smooth operator.
Yeah.
Yep. Okay, let's do NCAA. We got, the whole deal. Everybody's up there. Duke is awesome.
Yeah, Duke's doing well.
You know, Indiana was well, then they lost the game, but it doesn't matter. You can lose two or three games in the NCAA and be there in the tournament.
Yeah, exactly.
They're all looking at the one seeds. Who wants to be the one seed right now?
Yeah, yeah, and Ohio State's got a good squad this year again, even though they lost a little bit of good.
Now, Sellinger, speaking of Ohio State, looks pretty good in the pros. I was watching him with Boston. Yeah. He looks pretty nice, yeah.
I was checking that out, too. Yep. I was impressed.
I think the NCAA is coming around. I think Kentucky, it's going to be hard for them.
I agree.
I think if you start having that one-and-done squad, you might have some all-stars. You might have some real good looks at it, but it's so hard to get that team maturing.
Yeah,
and the secret of last year's team was they had the sophomores that stayed that extra year.
That's right, yeah. And that's when you look at a team like an Indiana where you have guys that have been playing together a couple, 3 years.
Yeah.
That's where a team that might not be as talented can defeat a more talented team that doesn't play as well together.
You know, I heard a very interesting thing. I heard an interview with Patrick Ewing, and Ewing was talking about how in college, the game was so cluttered. There was no room to score. So he was a defensive player. Where in the pros, the lane just opened wide up.
Uh-huh.
And so he was able to score in the pros. Never could score in college like that.
Wow.
That's kind of interesting.
Isn't it?
Yeah. So, you know, you look at these guys who come in, these big, you know, 6'10", Anthony Davis type scorers. You know, there's not a lot of room to score.
Yeah.
They got to be a defensive stopper.
Yeah.
Let's do best of, shall we?
Yeah, man.
Okay, best and worst of 2012. We always do our year in review. Let's kick this thing off with, in my opinion, the worst story we've ever talked about in sports. Sandusky blows every other story out of the water.
I totally didn't even put that on my year in review thing. Totally
Sandusky blows everything out of the water because you're talking about a guy who's in a football program, not just any football program, absolutely one of the top two or three most storied programs in the entire history of the thing.
Yep.
Completely entrenched coach who people have said has lost control, he's lost touch, all this other sort of stuff. Years before he retires.
Oh, yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
He retires, doesn't retire, gets booted, gets fired, and then dies.
Dies. Jesus.
Okay. Dude. Not only that, but you're talking about bringing basically the last, like, almost 15 years to a complete standstill in that town because of one guy with who knows how many kids.
Yeah.
The guy sets up a charity to fund and commit kids into, or lower impoverished kids or whatever, to bring into this little second mile thing or whatever as a little proving grounds. He's circling the names and circling. Oh, my Lord. It's like the Nazis.
Yeah, no shit. Dude.
I mean, it's seriously deep.
Yeah, like systematic.
And then his wife is totally, oh, nothing happened here. No, he's great. People love this guy. I mean, we're talking about this program went from, they were like, had, I think they had 8 wins or one loss or something.
Mm-hmm.
And then it all came crumbling down.
Yeah.
Then they lost the rest of the year. Then they go into this year. They go bowl band. The guy, Bill O'Brien, did a hell of a job this year trying to bring that program back.
Yeah.
They won more games than USC.
Yeah, that's
thought
crazy,
that was going to happen.
Yeah, not me.
But the Sandusky thing tears everything apart.
Yeah,
it goes
they lost
back to the,
they lost players to other teams.
Oh God, and it goes into the whole Catholic Church thing with the priests molesting kids. And I mean, you're talking about the word child molestation over and over, child rape and anal rape. I heard, I kept hearing all the. It was like, can we please on the radio where I'm trying to get a little of sports?
Yeah.
Breaking down the freaking horrors of child molestation.
Yeah, no shit.
Horrible shit, dude.
Yeah, unbelievable.
Unbelievable.
Man. And like, you could, if somebody wrote a script or wrote a book about this, I would be like, that's way too far fetched to ever be true.
It went down.
Yeah.
And it went down so fast and so quickly that it was like it was a blur.
Yeah.
I mean, and then you have the people that are defending the no. This can't be the, just like the Catholic Church thing. No, no, you're not. And then it's, yes, this went down.
Yeah, and then like you were saying, like the capper to it all is you've got, you know, Paterno, storied career.
You're tearing his statues off the wall.
Yeah, like taking the dude's pictures off the murals and stuff.
I mean, oh my God.
And then he
dies. Been there since the 60s, and he dies, like, 2 weeks later.
Yeah, almost like... Like, literally, like this killed him.
Yes.
Yeah.
It killed him. And,
We're talking about a guy who has like 40 grandkids.
Yeah.
Like Paterno's like old man Paterno. He's like huge fan. So I just the Sandusky thing just it was so far beyond recognition.
Yeah.
Unbelievable.
Yeah. Yeah.
And then the sanctions that come with it. Mm-hmm. 4-year bowl ban.
Yeah.
I mean it's crazy.
I still approve of your idea when you're saying you need to blow it up. You need to change everything. Change the unis, change the logos.
Logo, everything.
Yeah, just start fresh. I mean, you're never going to have a more appropriate time to change a lot of that.
But what a shame, though, for all those people who love tradition so much, they're so attached to tradition, that one guy could blow it.
Yep.
One guy could blow it. I mean, we're talking about, like, an empire.
Yeah.
Collapsing
because
of one person's actions.
Yep, college. Yeah, man, it's.
I mean, that is that's like some French Empire Napoleon type shit, and then all of a sudden it all crumbles and you lose it all.
Yeah,
because of one guy trying to fucking what? Get off with some little kids? I mean, it is ridiculous.
Yeah, it's unbelievable.
And this guy is now goes to jail, and he goes and he's like, "Oh, I don't think I've ever done anything wrong." Now everybody in their right mind knows exactly what this guy should have.
Yeah.
You know, and this goes back to the idea that we should, in essence, if we can all agree to it and we do it this fast, we get that swift justice, we go guillotine in the middle of the goddamn town square like they used to do.
Yeah, exactly.
There's only a few cases where you can do it, and this happens to be one of them. He wants to go to general population.
Yeah, well, that's good, because he'll be dead soon if he does
if that guy goes to general pop, he's done.
Yeah, they'll kill him in segregation, man.
Oh, yeah. So, my next thing is, we had a triple crown winner in baseball.
And I'm shocked because this has gotten very little coverage, really. I mean, there were people that were saying that he didn't even deserve the MVP for this.
Oh, yeah, the rookie should have won it.
Yeah, and I'm like,
what?
Dude won the triple crown. Like, if anything, there should be no question who gets it.
Yeah.
I mean, if there's ever
like
been...
That's like an asterisk. If you win this award...
Yeah, you're guaranteed the MVP. It. There should be no question about whether he gets it.
Unless, for whatever reason... The exact same thing happens in the American League and National League at the same time.
Right, yeah.
Then it's automatic. Those are your two MVPs.
Yeah, co-MVPs. Yeah.
It hasn't happened in the NL since, like, the 30s.
Yeah, unbelievable,
okay.
Dude.
So, MVP, okay, Miguel Cabrera, obvious. Okay, obvious. I don't care what Trout did. I don't even care.
Yeah.
One, Miguel Cabrera's team went into the playoffs, and he was hitting, like, 300 or 400 at the end of the year. He was hitting bombs the last week of the thing. Yeah. Trout was done. He was on the... I'm in college. I'm on the AAA team. I'm done. My year's over.
Yeah.
Okay, we got to break this thing down a little bit. Because as a baseball fan, I love numbers. We all love numbers. We all love stats. The Triple Crown is a real rarity in baseball. It does flat out doesn't happen. And we have people like myself, who's a part of an older, and you as well, we're part of this older baseball generation. We were brought up in it. We had the almanacs in our house. We broke down all the shit. We knew all that stuff.
Yeah.
There's a new generation that's completely doesn't understand it. They know it from playing video games. They don't even know. I mean, who the hell plays a baseball video game?
Yeah.
Okay, you got to hear these numbers, people. Triple Crown, three different stats. We're talking average. We're talking bombs. And we're talking...
Ribbies.
Possibly the most important stat is RBIs.
Yeah.
It is an absolute nectar stat because not only are you also getting a hit
or
at least getting putting the ball in play, but you're bringing somebody in.
Yeah.
Okay?
Yep.
So you got to understand these numbers, okay? So Miguel Cabrera goes, and I got them right here. They're kind of small here. Cabrera goes 330, 44 bombs, 139 RBIs.
Wow. Dude.
This is one of the best years ever. This is one of the best years of all time, okay? We're doing a little compare and contrast here. We got some time, so kick back. Okay? spark up your cigar.
I'm going to grab me some water.
Get some water, okay? Okay? The last one who won it was Yaz. Okay? Carly Skremski went 326, 44, and 121.
Mm.
So he's lesser in the average, same in bombs, and much less in the RBIs.
Yeah.
139 to 121. Yeah. That's 1967. The year before, Frank Robinson does it, okay? Robinson goes 316, 49 bombs, which is more bombs, but 122 on the ribbies, okay?
Yeah.
Then we've got the Mick.
Yeah.
Fucking Mickey Mantle, dude. 1956. Holy shit. The Mick goes 353.
Wow.
He goes 52 bombs.
Wow.
With 130 ribs.
Still not 139.
Miguel has more ribs.
Wow, okay? That's crazy.
I'm
dude.
Serious. This is ridiculous stuff here, okay?
And that's a lot more home runs, too.
Oh, God. 52 bombs compared to fucking, what, 44?
Yeah.
Okay. That's the Mick, okay? Ted Williams goes 2 in his career, okay? Wow. He does it in 47 and he does it in 42, okay? 47, okay? After the war, everybody's back.
Yeah, he was a fighter pilot.
Okay. Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. Everybody's back, okay? He's after the war here, okay? He goes 343, 32 bombs, 114.
Yep.
Pretty pedestrian.
Yeah.
He's got the good average, 343. But Miguel Cabrera's 330. He's still hitting a hell of an average,
yeah.
Okay? Williams, during the war, 42, when nobody's around, he goes 356, better than Mickey. He goes 36 bombs, but he goes 137 RBIs.
Wow.
Still not more than Miguel Cabrera.
Yeah.
Now, we're talking about a different season there, though.
Yeah.
We're talking about the 52-game schedule then.
Okay.
So Miguel Cabrera's got more numbers here with some of these guys, because now we're going back,
yeah.
Okay? Because we're in the 50s and we're in the 40s, okay? You want to go big time? We go back to 1922. We go with possibly one of the greatest baseball players of all time. Nobody wants to talk about is Rogers Hornsby.
Yeah.
Rogers Hornsby was an absolute beast. Played second base and hit yardage bombs. And hit unbelievable average. Okay, 1922, quite possibly one of the best years ever. He goes 401. 42 bombs with 152 ribs.
Oh my God.
In 150 game schedule with a dead ball.
What?
This is 22. This is before Ruth hits the hell out of the ball. 42
dude.
Bombs from a second baseman in a dead ball era. Okay. This is slow. This is not quite dead ball. It's like the next phase. It's not quite the 30s baseball. Lou Gehrig in 34 goes 363. With 49 bombs and 165 ribs.
Jesus.
So Gehrig's got the most ribs of anybody with 165. Mickey's got more bombs than anybody with 52. And the best average is gotta be Hornsby with 401.
Yeah.
Miguel Cabrera is like the third best Triple Crown ever.
Yeah. And look at those numbers, dude. Yeah.
Now he has the extra games, granted. But going from 154 to 162.
Yep.
That's a pretty amazing thing there.
Yeah.
And you think about how many guys have played the game.
Yeah.
Now, we're not talking about just one league. Everybody who's won is AL. The last NL winner was like in the 30s.
Wow.
So we're talking about, think of how many guys have played this sport who have hit for average. The perfect example is like a Frank Thomas.
Mm-hmm.
Frank Thomas was a great hitter for average, hit bombs, and you know he had ribs.
Yep.
He never could do it.
Yeah.
George Brett, great average, hit yards, and went for ribs.
Nope. Yeah.
I mean, we're talking some of the greatest players ever, and this guy, Cabrera, does it.
Yeah, unbelievable.
And he does it in a time, in a year, which actually the pitchers, some of the best years the pitchers have had for 15, 20 years.
Yeah.
We're in a pitcher resurgence right now.
Yeah, we sure are, man. Yeah.
And so the fact that he was able to come out and do that, I was blown away
dude,
with.
Dude, I dig those stats that you dug up, man. That's awesome.
But that's it. Okay, that's it. Now, the next one, since we're staying in baseball, I'm a Mets fan. R.A. Dickey wins the Cy Young.
Yeah.
The Mets have had 3 Cy Young winners. Seaver won 3 of them. Seaver was an absolute horse. Okay? And his numbers are ridiculous. Dr. K, my favorite player of all time, he won 185. And then Dickey. You got to hear Dr. K's stats real quick.
Yeah.
85.
Yeah.
He went 24-4.
Wow.
He went with a 1.53 ERA.
Oh my God, dude.
And he had 268 strikeouts. Now, his strikeout numbers aren't as good as some of the other guys who went, because there's the pitcher's Triple Crown as well.
Yeah.
And that's, he won it that year. You got to have those 3 stats. You got to have wins and losses. You got to have ERA. And you got to have strikeouts. But,
wow.
Yeah. Seaver wasn't close on any of those, and Dickey wasn't close. Dickey's a, who the hell throws a knuckle and wins a Cy Young?
Yeah, that's phenomenal.
From a team that doesn't even win.
Yeah.
The Mets were shitty this year.
Yeah.
And, of course, in pure Mets fashion, what do you do? trade him to the Blue Jays.
Send him to Canada.
Now, supposedly got some good players, but shit, haven't we heard that before as Mets fans? I know this guy can strike people out tomorrow.
Mm-hmm.
Let's trade him. Let's give him to Toronto.
Let's get some prospects in here.
Toronto's got now a whole lineup. They have the whole Miami Marlins team from last year. Now they've got Dickey. And I think they brought in some other pitcher. And they already have Batista, who's a hell of a hitter.
Yeah.
Okay, LeBron. Talk about Triple Crown.
Yeah.
League MVP.
Yep.
Didn't go scoring champ.
No.
But league MVP, he said, I don't get paid to be scoring here. League MVP, finals MVP,
nope.
Championship, gold medal.
Yeah.
And really also got that gigantic gorilla monkey off his back.
Yeah, yeah.
Which was absolutely so crucial.
Yeah.
And now that one is firmly on the back of Carmelo Anthony.
It is, yeah, that's a good
and
point.
And Carmelo's feeling it, and I would not get in Carmelo's way this year.
Yeah,
he's that team looks dominant.
Yeah, they do. That's a good-looking team they have up there. Yeah, I just got to say, man, LeBron, I mean...
Cheers to LeBron.
Yeah,
dude.
Man.
He's our country superhero.
Yeah, he's...
He's what is the best thing we have going right now.
I agree, man. He's the best. I think he's the best athlete in professional sports.
Ever.
Yeah, yeah.
I would put him
above
anybody ever of all time.
Name me another guy that has the size, the strength, the agility, the quickness, the speed, because there is a difference. The jumping ability, the intelligence, the unselfishness, the ability to adapt to the game and make others around him better.
We love football players, right?
Yeah.
Cam Newton.
Yeah.
LeBron's 3 inches taller and 15 pounds heavier.
Yeah.
And faster. And more athletic.
Yeah. Shit, dude.
I mean, that's just unfair.
Yeah.
It's literally unfair. And I love basketball. I love history. Magic Johnson, and I've got him right here. My poster is of game, whatever it was, game six or whatever it was, against Philly, where he had to play for
Kareem
and had to play the center position.
Yeah.
Legendary.
Yeah.
LeBron can do that every single night.
Yeah.
Against every single team, including the Olympics.
You know, that's a great point, because you take a guy like Magic and have LeBron guard
him. One game. Magic did one game.
What's Magic going to do with LeBron guarding him? He's not going to be able to push him in the post. Magic isn't going to be able to post him up. He's not going to be able to blow by
Magic's
him.
Magic's not faster than LeBron.
He's not going to be able to do a step back because LeBron will throw it back in his face.
Nor did Magic have that much of a jumper.
And Magic couldn't guard LeBron to save his life.
No.
That's another thing is that LeBron is lockdown defense.
Absolutely. Magic was like a power forward playing point guard.
Yeah.
LeBron is like the biggest three ever.
Yeah.
The guy is just ridiculous. And like we're talking about his intelligence, his unselfishness. Those are the things that set him so much farther apart from a guy like Wilt, a guy like Jordan, a guy like, Kareem even. Those guys all wanted to be the man. Those guys all wanted to be the best player. Those guys had their own ego thing, Kobe as well.
Oh, yeah.
Those guys are all trapped in their deal.
Mm-hmm.
Not LeBron. LeBron's going to pass to them. LeBron is ridiculous, and that is a great run.
Yeah, the unselfishness you were talking about, you got like the Jordans and the Wilts and the Kobes who have that need to be the man at all times. And you were saying that...
They're locked in. They're in prison.
And you're saying, because that's their whole world is their abilities and what they're going to do to put the ball in the basket, where LeBron, it's like he's got a much...
He's free.
Yeah, he's got this wide open... palette to play with, and people wanted to
hate on him for that. People hated on him for passing the Daniel Gibson or whatever the guy's name was.
Yeah, yeah.
So the other guy, I think the only other person to ever do that is Jordan in '92. I think Jordan won everything in '92. MVP,
finals MVP,
final
gold medal.
Yeah. That was dream team. So I got some other stuff here. I think let's go back to PAC12.
Good.
OSU.
Yeah.
And Stanford. Unbelievably strong seasons for both those teams.
Yeah.
Stanford goes to the Rose Bowl.
Yeah.
Beats
impressive.
Oregon. Man. They host the PAC-12 championship.
Who
saw that?
Yeah, nobody. Yeah.
Nobody. Okay. OSU was undefeated at one point. I want to say 6-0.
Yeah.
Top 10.
Top 10,
in the country.
Unbelievable.
For multiple weeks.
Yeah, that's right.
Okay. Have an opportunity
both of those teams have an opportunity to win a really good bowl that is going to go into their lineage of
accomplishment. Yeah,
this is an important deal for both of them.
I agree, yeah, definitely.
Wisconsin has a really shitty season, but they're not that shitty of a team. The Wisconsin-Stanford game is what we wanted last year.
Yeah.
That's the matchup we want. That's power on power.
Yeah.
The Oregon State-Texas matchup is great. Pro style.
Yeah.
One up-and-coming Pac-12 team, power dominant program that's kind of on their ass the last couple, 3 years, Texas.
Yeah, Mac Brown's been having some problems down
there. Both kind of older coaches, established coaches. I think the Alamo Bowl has a lot of potential to be a great bowl.
Yeah.
Top five of the whole thing.
Yeah, I agree, man. Yeah. It's great. It's great for those schools, great for the Pac-12. It's great for the West, the Northwest.
Staying with college football, Bama wins again.
Yeah.
Rebuilding year. Rebuilding with five-star athletes and able to go right back to the national championship. And instead of playing an SEC school this year, you get to play the Domers. Notre Dame is a hell of a story this year.
Yeah.
Okay? Yeah. They didn't quite have the horror of the Sandusky trial or the terribleness of this, but they did have a tragedy last year. They had the video kid die.
That's right. Yeah, that's right.
You have a new coach. Third year? Second year?
I think second year.
Not really that much expected of them. Always a name brand. Always a team that people want to follow and watch. But who's expecting much out of Notre Dame this year?
Yeah.
You get some close wins. You get some wins you shouldn't have. All of a sudden, you're undefeated. You're playing Alabama in the national championship.
Yep, you're title bound.
And for me, a traditionalist, I think this is how it should be.
Yeah.
I think Oklahoma, I think Texas, I think SC, Michigan, Ohio State, Florida, Georgia, Bama, Notre Dame.
Yeah, it's good. I'm
Oregon.
I'm much more happy having a team like Notre Dame than a kind of a flash in the pan like a Boise State TCU or something like that.
And Notre Dame is a team that played everybody all year
they had a tough schedule. Hell of a schedule.
Everybody all year was saying the schedule. So. Yeah. It made, and I think it's also awesome that they're the only team that was undefeated. So nobody could say shit.
Yeah, that's right.
It's because you know if they were the same as somebody else, everybody would be on them.
Everybody would be above them,
yep. And everybody's like, oh, Purdue, Michigan State, Michigan, who gives a shit about all blah, 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 you know. Yeah. So it would come back to bite them.
Yeah, and they weren't even ranked to start the season.
No.
They weren't even in the top 25 preseason
like rankings. You're saying. Notre Dame is in the out of the rankings, and they end up number one.
Yep.
SC was number one, and they end up out of the
not
rankings.
Not even ranked.
Who would have thought that happened?
I know, man. No shit.
That's amazing.
Yeah.
NBA, which is fantastic. We had 2012 was the year of Linsanity.
That's right. Yeah. It was crazy, man. And
there was a time that people
He was killing it, dude.
People, literally, it was the leading story to like the nightly news.
Yeah.
It had branched over from sport. It was a phenomenon.
Yeah,
it was bigger than sports. It was into like, it was like, President Obama did something today, but hang on a second. Linsanity.
Yeah.
Jeremy Lin, an Asian player, was really good last night in basketball. That's amazing. The Linsanity thing, I think, had so much to do with race.
Yeah.
And I think it had so much to do with the fact that New York hasn't been good and they finally started to get good.
Yeah.
And it totally, totally had something to do with the fact that Carmelo's out.
Yeah, I agree too.
If Carmelo's on the floor, he's not getting the ball.
Yeah, exactly.
Carmelo goes out. He's the only option on the Knicks.
Yep.
He's going to score buckets. Anybody who like watched basketball or knew what they were watching was seeing an opportunistic point guard.
Yeah.
That's what you want your point guard to be.
Yep.
A guy who's going to pass the ball when there's nobody to pass to. Score, baby.
Uh-huh. Yeah, and
keep us in the ball game.
He did it on what's considered one of the biggest stages in the NBA, Madison Square Gardens. Yep. He was doing it
against some of the best competition as well.
Yeah. And he was also, like you were saying, I think that people saw, like, from the NBA standpoint, they saw a whole market open up. Like, obviously, NBA is popular in Asia. Mm-hmm. You got the Yao Ming and stuff
like
that. But
that Northern Californian Asian market just wide open, opened up.
I mean, it's crazy. And the media loved it, too, because here you have a kid, undrafted, out of Harvard.
Well, it's a great story. It says everything about the story, not about the substance.
Yeah, exactly. So it's, I don't know.
Now he goes to Houston. Who gives a shit?
Yeah, he's not doing that great. I mean, he's got Harden.
The media capital of the world, the basketball, there's nothing else going on. Totally dead. It's after the Super Bowl.
Yeah.
Nobody's following anything else.
Exactly. Here, we got our headline for you.
Exactly. Yeah. Back to baseball for a second. In the year of Pujols getting one of the biggest deals ever, and people not making even close to a big a deal about it as much as A-Rod. They hated A-Rod for that deal.
Yeah, they did.
They signed also Hamilton to the exact same money they did to A-Rod.
Did they really?
A-Rod was a 10-year, $250 million contract. Hamilton's a 5-year, $125.
Wow,
same
dude.
Fucking thing.
Unbelievable.
When you go back to the Los Angeles Angels, they signed everybody they could, and they got beat by the Oakland A's. Yeah. The Yankees, of course, top payroll in the
by far. Yeah.
And who's winning that division? Almost. The Baltimore Orioles.
Yeah.
So this whole era of big spending and big dollars or anything else has really shown us that you don't got to spend money to win.
Yeah.
If you are the Oakland A's or you are the Baltimore Orioles, you are sitting on a pile of cash.
Mm-hmm.
You're not giving it to all these players. The players are not oversaturated and over fat. They're still hungry.
Yep.
They come to the ballpark every day. Now, you only might get 1 or 2 years because all those players might bolt for bigger contracts than other teams.
That's right.
Like the Angels and the Yankees.
Mm-hmm.
But for that couple, 3 years, that formula, absolutely solid gold.
That's right. Yeah.
What other GM writes a book? Not only that, but a book that gets picked up into a Hollywood movie.
Yeah, no
shit. Who gives a shit about a goddamn baseball GM? So something's happening there in Oakland.
Yeah.
And I love to see it because they are a team that are literally either the worst team in the division or the best team in the division. They're never 500.
Yeah, it's fantastic. It's good for baseball, man.
Yeah. My next one is Tim Tebow.
Oh, man. Talk about going from a high of winning a playoff game with that bullet pass in first play of overtime.
Yeah,
ADR. To getting dished to the Jets.
To the punt team.
Yeah.
He's on punt team.
And they're starting McElroy.
Yes.
Because they pulled Sanchez. Yes. They're not even going to start Tebow. They're going to start McElroy.
Yeah. I mean, imagine
Alabama
going
quarterback
from
last year.
Two-time Heisman Trophy winner.
Tebow, yeah.
Youngest Heisman Trophy winner before Manziel.
Yep.
Two-time winner.
Yep, won, I think, 2 or 3 national championships?
Yes. At least two. I think it's just the two.
Yeah.
May have been. I don't know. I think just the two. Yeah. But then goes to the pros and gets a first-round draft pick.
Mm-hmm.
Becomes starting quarterback after the guy leaves or whatever.
Yeah,
and
Kyle Orton gets benched or whatever.
And wins a playoff game and then goes to the punt team.
Unbelievable.
But the biggest celebrity punt team ever. That guy gets more coverage than anybody.
Yeah, right. Now, what's going to happen to him?
I hear he's going to go to Jacksonville.
Oh, is that right?
Yeah.
Oh, interesting.
Now, if Jacksonville brings in...
Blaine Gabbert down there in Jacksonville.
Well, I don't think Blaine Gabbert's the answer. I think if you're Jacksonville, all you're trying to do is get people in the seats.
Yeah, and that's
since,
true.
That's the closest thing to Gainesville.
Yeah, that's a great
point.
Lots
of Villes down there.
Yeah, it is. Jacksonville, yeah. Gainesville.
Okay, my other one is the Colts.
Mm.
The Colts go from the Peyton Manning
leaving,
having to get rid of, crying in the post-game, or post-interview.
Yeah,
the
press conference.
Press conference.
Yeah.
To Andrew Luck, to going to the playoffs.
Unbelievable, dude. Yeah.
I mean, the whirlwind of that whole fan base has got to be bizarre.
Yeah, because there were people saying stick it out with Peyton, trade the number one draft pick and get a couple maybe other lesser first round picks and just go with the old man.
Yeah, bring some defense in, bring the receiver in, do it. Yeah. What does Peyton do this year? Oh, I don't know. Goes out and has like an MVP season.
Yeah, no shit. Gets another 12-win year.
The only quarterback that's better than him is Tom Brady.
Yeah. Yep.
And people would probably maybe question that if this year maybe Peyton isn't having a better year than Brady.
Yeah, I agree, man. Yeah.
So, I mean, that is unbelievable that they go Manning and then they go Luck and then the whole thing opens. I mean, that blew my mind.
And it's one of these situations where it's almost like It was a win-win for everybody.
Everybody won.
The Colts got a new stud young quarterback who's killing it.
And best quarterback since Elway.
Yeah, and the Broncos are in the got a clinch playoff spot. They're going to do well this year.
Who would you rather have? The 2012-2013 Broncos going to the playoffs or the 2011-2012 Broncos going to the playoffs?
Right, exactly. See what I'm saying? Yeah, totally. Yep.
And that's pretty much it for me. Other than the fact that you've got that other thing about the Oakland A's and Baltimore, you've got the Angels and the Red Sox implosion that happened this year. Bobby V and all that stuff was pretty bad.
Yeah.
Just real quickly, my picks at the beginning of the year, I liked Oregon and SC. Obviously, nice. SC was bad. I liked FSU. I liked Georgia. I liked Wisconsin. I liked Michigan, Oklahoma, LSU. Pretty easy to pick those.
Yeah.
Those worked out pretty well. Giants, no. Packers, yes. New England, yes. Pittsburgh, no. Baltimore, yes. Giants, who the hell picked Seattle? I picked Seattle as my one of my least favorite teams in the whole league. I thought they were going to be one of the worst teams in the whole league.
Two spots down from Indy.
Yes, and I thought Jacksonville was going to be as good as Seattle. Atlanta, we all saw that coming, but who the hell saw Denver?
Yeah.
They did. And then Houston, that's pretty obvious. So,
yeah, that's good, man.
Yeah, I'm not a really, like, you know, a prognostication guy, but we always do our beginning of the year. What do we think?
Yeah, I don't know. The other things that I was going to say is for ups and downs.
2012.
We had Lance Armstrong stripped of his gold medals. It was coming.
Everybody, whole sport cheats.
Yeah.
How does the guy that beats everybody in the sport not cheat?
Yeah.
Just the simple math equation alone is wrong.
Yep. You got Rory McIlroy finishing the year as the world's number one golfer. People could have seen that coming. He had the blow up at
the Masters.
Yeah. But, you know.
Rory is strong. Tiger won 3 tournaments.
Yeah. So he's doing a little comeback. We had Olympics, Michael Phelps, most medals and gold medals.
Woo!
That was incredible.
So is a swimmer the best Olympian ever? We talked about this in the summer.
Yeah. You know.
Because he's got more medals. It looks like he just had one more crack at it.
Yes, he just had more opportunities.
He had one more opportunity.
Yeah, because it's, there's more.
He had 3 different Olympics to win medals in.
Yeah.
And in all 3 Olympics, he kicked ass.
Yeah. So you can't do
But he had more medals than, like, the Russian gymnasts. And if you get more medals than the old Russian gymnast, you gotta be kick ass, dude.
Yeah, no doubt. What else we got? Super Bowl champs, preseason number 1. Yeah, that's about it for me, too.
2012 was pretty bizarre. Now, on the duck level, right where we probably wanted to be, obviously people wanted to be in the national championship.
Yeah.
But I think it is pretty sweet that we're not going to go to the Rose Bowl again. The Rose Bowl would have been a lesser bowl.
Yeah.
The Rose Bowl, you'd be playing Wisconsin. Nobody wants to see a rematch of that and that this year. You get to the Fiesta Bowl. Fiesta Bowl is just as good, if not even better, than the Rose Bowl. Obviously, we look at the Rose Bowl, the West Coast being the granddaddy. But the Fiesta Bowl, in a unique situation, can have 2 better teams and have a better game.
Yeah.
We're going to have a great time. We're going to Phoenix. I'm going to soak it up. I saw the press conference today, and Kelly looks like he's having fun. I would see Kelly staying, people. Don't bank on it.
Yep.
And because here's the deal. Kelly can literally, he knows that he can last for 20 years at Oregon if he wanted to.
Yeah.
He can't guarantee 2 years in the NFL.
Yeah. Yeah, exactly.
So,
I mean, look at the track record of all the guys that have gone and come back. I mean, it's ridiculous. All
right, guys. Let's do our top 10 rules crypto shopping real quick.
Yep.
Get this thing done. Thanks for watching. You've been here an hour. We love it. Okay, number 10. Let's go quality or quantity on the Christmas gifts.
Yeah.
You go with the big set, the big diamond earring thing, or the big thing, and you go with the heavy-duty one, or give her a lot of other stuff.
Yeah, a lot of little things, a lot of little creature comfort stuff, scarves, gloves, whatever. Yeah.
My mother-in-law has bought me pajama pants for the last 3 years.
I got pajama pants this year, yeah.
This year's pajama pants, the softest texture I've ever felt of anything. Pretty sweet. Number 9, buy early, get it done.
Yeah.
Buy in the summer.
Yeah.
Start stacking stuff away early.
Yeah, it's a smart move.
Don't cut into the budget early or late on.
Yeah.
And you get some good, better deals, and you just start putting stuff away.
Yeah, it's a smart move. You're less stress, all that.
Number 8, you got to go summer gear.
Ah, you know, that's a great point. Because,
buy some sunglasses.
Yeah, because you're thinking, well, I'm going to buy her something they can use now, but it's not winter time year round. No. I mean, Yeah, it's a great time.
And to have her starting stuff. To look at something, or her, I would say, but, you know, get somebody something's going to look in the future. New exactly. sunglasses is perfect.
Yeah, when it starts warming up, they get to use this brand new gift that
Amen.
They got.
Love it.
Yeah.
And it makes you think about the summer when you're in the middle of the winter. Yeah. That's always
gets
nice.
Gets you out of the doldrums.
Yeah. Number 7, don't worry. If you're late, that's fine. Everybody's late. You go to the Christmas shopping that last day, everybody's there anyway. So yeah. you're going to still be able to get the gear you need to
yeah.
get.
Yeah,
you There's can... plenty of shit out there.
Yeah, it'll be crowded. It'll be a pain in the ass, but you can still get it done.
And you get to see the slice of humanity.
It is really an interesting,
some interesting shit.
Yeah, it's an interesting observation on
people flipping each other off in the
behavior.
Parking lot. And a really good secret on that one, if you do go the last day, park across the street. Don't even fuck with the parking lot.
That's a good idea,
park
man.
Right across the street, yeah. just walk through that parking
no
lot.
No stress walk.
No stress.
Yep.
Come right back to your car. Everything's cool.
Yeah, that's a good idea.
People are breaking into the cars in the parking lot, yep. not on the street.
Yeah.
Okay, let's do number 6. Handmade gifts. Great if you're an adult. Not if you're a kid.
Yeah.
So it's one of those deals, if you got an adult there, hand make that gift.
Yeah.
You're doing it to a kid, that kid's going to hate that thing.
Yeah, they're going to be bummed out about the Tonka trucks and the computer, well, that ages me, about the latest computer games that they wanted. They're going to be like, I don't need mittens, but now that I'm a little older.
That brand new scarf?
Yeah, I appreciate the time, the planning, the personal touch. So.
Yeah, it's nice.
Yeah.
The next one is, you got to number 5 here. You got to try something different.
Yeah.
Give a gift that's going to expand somebody's horizons.
Yeah, try them out. The five-finger, like, shoes, you know. Now is a good time to get somebody those. Because each
toe has their own thing.
Their own little capsule, yeah. I mean, people get to try out stuff they normally would never buy for themselves.
Right.
Another one is, like, if you've never had an acupuncture before, you know, get somebody an acupuncture gift certificate. Things that they would never and have never done before.
Right.
Yeah. Broaden their horizons. Yeah. Expand their world for them.
Yeah, expand.
Yeah.
Number 5. Now let's go to number 4. You got to budget that money as you're rolling down the stretch.
Yeah.
If you're down the stretch and you're thinking, holy crap, do I got enough for this? Do I got enough for that? Do I got enough for this? Do I got enough for that? You got to just kind of blow it at that point, right?
Yeah, at some point you just go, fuck it, I'm going to blow the money. I don't give a damn. I'll
make it in January.
Yeah.
Make it up later.
Yeah, exactly. I'll face that cross when I come to it.
Yeah, exactly. Number 3, you got to understand, it's for the kids, man. So don't get too all heated up about, I didn't get it. You get all in a tissy about something.
Yeah.
It's for the kids, dude.
Yeah, I mean, honestly, it's not really.
Give your gift away. Shit.
Yeah, exactly. That's a great point, man. Yeah, remember that.
Plus, if you're a grown man, you should be buying yourself exactly what you want anyway and not waiting for somebody else to buy you what they think you want.
Yeah, and you can do that year-round. You don't need
Anytime
to wait for
Anytime you
Christmas.
Want. You want a new knife? Buy yourself a new knife. You want a new hat? Buy yourself a new hat. You want some shoes? You put them on. You want a pair of pants? You do it. You don't wait for somebody to buy you shit. Like, oh, thanks, a new pair of jeans that won't fit me. That's awesome. No, you do that. So it's number 3, it's for the kids. Number 2, you gotta buy gifts that fit for the house. Okay? Right. Now, this went down personally in my family. I've got a small bungalow. My house is built in 1924, classic little Southeast Portland joint. My unks went big this year. He went with the arcade game kind of thing that you would buy or have for an arcade where you have the two baskets where you get to compete against each other and shoot.
Papa shot. Whatever, yeah.
Yeah. It's 7 feet tall, it's 7 feet long, it's 5 feet wide. It's a pretty big load. It's great for a house in the suburbs where you got 14 rooms, you don't know what to do with them. Perfect.
Yeah.
High ceilings, awesome game.
Yeah, three-car
chain net.
Three-car garage.
Three-car garage, perfect. Man cave, awesome. This is my man cave, and this is the back of it, so I can't really have a lot of room for that. So when we talk about this thing, you gotta buy a gift that's gonna fit in the house or the apartment. Don't get them the gigantic roller coaster that they can't fit in the house.
Yeah. Now, you got to give props for thinking big.
Dude,
that's
it's the thought that counts.
Yeah, exactly.
Huge thought, huge big, got to go large. Holy crap, can't fit it. Oh, yeah. Now what do you do?
Yeah.
Okay, I installed I'm a big Nerf hoop fan, and I got a new Nerf hoop. It's not Nerf. It's actually a real rim.
No way!
And it's a little bit bigger.
That's cool.
I drilled it right into the frame of the door. Okay, old wood, just perfect. It was awesome. So I already got my hoop. Thank you very much.
Yep.
Okay, so buy gifts that fit, and because it just keeps the tension low. Number 1, this is my wife's, gifts are overrated. So that whole thing about getting all worked up about the thing, let it go. It's how you act the other 364 days of the year that really count. Nice. That one day doesn't really mean much.
Yeah, you can't make up for being an ass all year long on Bling. One day. Yeah, right.
All right, I'm going to hit the strip club.
Yeah, right.
All right, people, so I'm off. I'm going to head to the game. I'll get the video. I'll film whatever I can down there. I'll maybe do a little couple live tweet. If you want to follow us on Twitter, there's really nothing to follow. But you can be a part of our network if you want. We're on Twitter, SportsChat503. We're on Facebook, same thing, blah, blah, blah. You know how we do it. We're here for Oregon fans. We're here for anybody else that's interested. Thank you very much for the holidays and everything else out there, people.
Yeah, it was a good 2012, man. A lot of good stuff.
Great stuff, man. Yep. Yeah. All right, people. Let's get this Duck victory against these Wildcats and have a good time down in Phoenix. And then I'll have a great New Year, everybody. And we'll see you after the New Year's. We'll come back maybe the week after, give the whole recap of what we saw in the game, and that'll be a great one for everybody to watch. And then we'll go through the doldrums of the rest of the year in February and talk about who our favorite all-star team of the 1920s in baseball was. Leading the charge is Rogers Hornsby.
Dude, those stats were awesome. I love that you broke out of those stats.
Dude, Mickey Mantle was a stud.
Yeah.
I mean, absolute stud. And a great alcoholic, too, as I heard.
Yeah, I mean, he's good at a lot of
stuff. He's good at a lot of things. Yeah. All right, people. Sports Chat 503. Thanks a lot for watching, everybody.
Happy New Year, kids.